Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to the last Arena Online Seminar of the year. My name is Thanasis Psaltis from TU Darmstadt, and I will be chairing today's seminar. Before we start, I would like to remind you that this session is recorded and it will be available in Gina's website or YouTube channel in the next few days. Also, remember to mute your microphones and keep your questions for the end of the seminar. After the end of the session, we're also hosting an informal meeting at Gathertown, where you can meet the speaker and also other seminar attendees. So I will also post the link for the Gathertown in a few minutes. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Arthur Soplan. Arthur obtained his PhD in 2018 from the University of Geneva in Switzerland, where he worked in the Stellar Evolution Group with Georges Meunier and Sylvia Ekstrom, and also collaborated with Rafa Hirschi. A year later, he moved to Japan and Kolon University to work as a postdoc with Tominaga-san. And since last summer, he is a postdoc fellow and teaching assistant at Université Libre de Bruxelles, working with Lynn Lucies and Stefano Gorielli. Dr. Soplan's research interests are focused in the evolution and nucleosynthesis of low metallicity massive and AGB stars. And his research tries to answer the question of the origin of the most metal poor stars, how they are evolved, and what was their nucleosynthetic output. Today, he will talk to us about non-standard neutron capture processes in massive and AGB stars. So whenever you're ready, Arthur, you can take it away.
Okay, yes. Thank you very much, Thanasis. Thank you very much. So hello, everyone. So it's a bit late here in Brussels, but I'm very happy to be here. And first of all, thank you very much for inviting me for this seminar. And I'm very pleased today to present some work on the non-standard neutron capture processes in massive and AGB stars. Okay, I can. Okay. So this is the outline for today. I would like, in the first part, to discuss a little bit the nucleosynthesis in low-metallicity rotating massive stars and discuss two.
Arthur cannot see the second slide.
Okay. Can you see it here? The outline.
I cannot.
Okay. Try again.
We can see that. Yeah. Can I go to the next one?
Next one here.
We cannot see the next one. We cannot see the outline page.
Okay. So I am on the next one. So this happens sometimes. Should I?
I mean, you can do it like that, like proceed like that, and just it should be fine.
Yeah.
Unless you have animations or.
No, like that should be fine. Just a little bit smaller, but okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, I can. Okay, that's maybe a little bit better. So the outline is the first part. I would like to discuss a little bit the nucleosynthesis in low metallicity rotating massive stars and discuss two processes that can happen in such stars, and actually the S process that can be enhanced, and also the N process. I will discuss that. And the second part, a little bit on the intermediate neutron capture process in AGB stars. So, but before that, a bit of context. So you have here, as you all know, I think the solar abundances that we can get by looking at the solar photosphere or by inspecting some primitive meteorites. And we can also already learn a lot from these solar abundances, especially the existence of probably a slow and a rapid neutron capture process that can explain these peaks here of barium, xenon, and lead. So we can already find a lot of information in it. And actually, these solar abundances are reflecting all the previous nucleosynthesis events that happened before the birth of the sun. Before the birth of the sun. So this is here a very schematic view of the time from the chemical evolution from the first stars to the birth of the sun. And here is the results in red. The pattern is the results of this nucleosynthetic event. This is an integration of many previous events. And in these events, at some point, there was probably a S process event, R process event to explain and many other nucleosynthetic processes. So I would like also, we have the sun, but we can also look at other stars. And I would like to mention the metal poor stars, which are very interesting to infer something on the early universe, because these stars have much less metal than in the sun. And then they formed earlier when the universe was younger. And there are actually a very nice window on the early universe. So when you look at these metal poor stars, you find that they are not so much solar-like, and you have different kinds of metal poor stars. I try to list here some of them. Maybe there are some other classes that exist, but here are actually most of the class we know, I think. At very low metallicity, you find in blue the no stars here, which do not show so much enhancements in heavy elements. And in yellow, you find the other stars that are enriched in heavy elements, the star showing some S process signature, the S stars, the R stars that show some R process signature, maybe some limited R stars showing maybe like a weak R process signature, the R plus S, so maybe a superposition of R and S process, and the R slash S or the I stars. I'm quite interested in this star today. And this is stars that are showing some chemical composition which is intermediate between S and R. And it's a bit difficult to explain these stars with the R process or with an S process nucleosynthesis. And even sometimes it's a bit difficult to explain with a combination of R and S process. And this is why there is a possible explanation for this, which is the I process. So I will discuss this in the second part. And when you see this, you may think that the sources and the nucleosynthesis processes in the universe, especially in the early universe, they seem to be quite diverse actually. And the metal poor stars, but the stars in general, I would say, are very nice cosmic laboratories to learn about nucleosynthesis. And a big challenge is to identify all the nucleosynthesis processes and to try to associate each process to its source. Okay, so let me focus now on the first part. So here is the schematic view of the evolution of nucleosynthesis happening in a massive star, let's say more than 10 solar mass, without rotation. So you have all these burning stages here from core hydrogen to core silicon, which are shorter and shorter, let's say about 10 megayear from about 1 day. In the end, you have this onion-like structure with many different shells made of different material. And in each of these burning phases, you can form different kinds of elements. During the second stage here, there is the weak S process that can happen. And it was studied by in the 80s and in the 90s, especially. In the helium burning core of massive star, there is this reaction that can release neutron, so neon 22 plus helium 4, and this neutron can be captured by heavy seeds to form heavier seeds. So this is the weak S process by opposition to the main S process that is expected to happen in AGB stars, so in lower mass stars. So AGB star, I will come back on this kind of star later. But what is the impact of rotation here? What can be the impact of rotation? We know that the massive stars are rotating. So this is the picture without rotation, but we know that the massive stars are rotating. This is here the observation report of about 500 nearby massive stars that were observed a few years ago. And this is here the distribution of the equatorial velocity. You see that there are some massive stars that are non-rotating, but a lot of them are actually rotating quite fast, or at least at some velocity, and some are also rotating even faster than 200 or 300 kilometers per second. So this is here in this is not here the very low metallicity stars, but this is just some nearby massive stars. So there are many works that try to investigate the effect of rotation in massive stars. And here are some of the effects. So rotation can make the star oblate, meaning centrifugal effect can make the polar radius smaller than the equatorial radius. You have a kind of oblate like this, oblate shape of the star. It can also impact the final fate of the star and trigger some peculiar explosions. I will come back on that after a little bit, and also enhance the mass loss, the rotation, and trigger some mixing in the interior of the star, thanks to meridional currents or shear mixing, maybe. And this can transport, this rotational mixing, transport angular momentum from a zone to another in the star, and also transport some chemical elements to a zone to another, from a zone to another in the star. So this here, the mixing during stellar evolution, is quite interesting during this stage. So I come back to the previous slide, but now with rotation, during this corium burning stage, you have actually a mixing that happens between the helium burning core and the hydrogen burning shell, kind of slow mixing that leads to exchanges of material between the helium burning core and the hydrogen shell. And this leads to special nucleosynthesis. So products of helium burning core, of helium burning are transported to the shell and vice versa. So here is a very rough and schematic picture. There are books, many papers and books dealing with the rotation in stars and how to implement rotation in models. So we have to, of course, it's not just some mixing put by hand. You have to solve some diffusive advective equations. But here I just show a very schematic picture. I think that's maybe enough to understand the main points. And a result of this, I can discuss a bit more in detail if you're interested, but a result of this rotational mixing is to have that you have more neon 22 in the helium burning core. So this is a result of, I skip here the details, but this is one of the effects of the rotational mixing. And if you have more neon 22, you can make this reaction stronger and produce more neutrons. And then the S process can be boosted. And this was shown about 10 years ago in the work of, for instance, Pignatari and Hirschi in 2008. Okay, so here I just show the results of one rotating and non-rotating model of 40 solar mass at low metallicity. And here this, you have y-axis the abundance or mass fraction, and x-axis is the atomic number. You see the initial composition in dashed line, non-rotating star in black. So here you still have some S process, some weak S process. But when you include fast rotation, you can enhance by a lot the production of S process elements, of heavy elements. And this was investigated in some recent works by Urs Fischner and myself also. We did some small grid of massive rotating stars, including a big network in order to follow the S process. Also, Limondi and Kefi, and they did also a nice work, and they computed some rotating star with the big network, and Banerjee, which is a work also with Alex Eger, I think, they did some stars like this. So there are not so much works, it's quite recent work, but yes, all these works agree that there is an enhancement of the S process with rotation, at least qualitatively. So this is how the model looks like at the end of the evolution, the fast rotating one. You have here the pre-supernova star. So here again, it's a very schematic view, but this is actually how it is. The initial mass was 40 solar mass. The final mass, it's just 24 because this star has lost some mass. You have a thin hydrogen shell. You have a helium shell here in blue, which is made of S process elements. So it's rich in S process elements and also in neon 22, which was not totally burnt during the evolution, and the core. And I would like to discuss next the effect of an explosion on this star. So I will not discuss the classic explosion, but I would like to focus on a special kind of explosion that can happen in massive rotating stars. Actually, it was shown that rotation in massive stars may trigger aspherical or jet-like explosions. And this, actually, the existence of aspherical or jet-like explosions, at least, is supported by the observation of, for instance, long gamma ray bursts or asphericities in various supernovae. I'm not saying that rotation is responsible for these aspherical jet-like explosions, but I would say it's maybe a good candidate. And if you have a jet-like explosion, you have a special, high entropy environments, and that would lead to a special explosive nucleosynthesis. So if I take my model here just before the explosion, I would like to see the effect of a jet passing through the star and especially through the blue layers, which are enriched in S process. So this is what we did with Tominaga-san in Japan. I used a 2D hydro code to model a jet of about 10 seconds passing into the stellar mantle. I would say in this case, it was an energetic jet of about 10 to the 52 erg with an opening angle of 5 degrees. And here you see two snapshots at 2 and 5 seconds. You have here the line is showing in the star the bottom of the helium shell. And you see here the temperature in color. And we have calculated after that the nucleosynthesis in post-processing. We follow the temperature and density history of the stellar mantle with some mass particles. And during the jet, actually, the temperature in the helium shell is very high and high enough to reactivate very efficiently this reaction, neon 22 alpha. And there is here, because of this, a neutron burst that leads to a neutron density up to 10 to the 19 cubic centimeter during, I would say, less than 1 second. So this is not our process. It's not our process. Here, I just give you typical R process. It's at least 10 to the 20, the neutron density. So here, it's not a R process, but it's not so far. So here are the chemical composition of the in the star in the S-rich region just before the jet in the proton neutron plane, and the color is showing the abundance, the amount of a given element. But this is not so much important to look at in detail. Just see the difference just before and after the jet. So just after the jet, you have that this kind of intermediate region is populated between the value of stability here and the, I would say here in blue is a typical R process flow. So it's not a R process, but you see that with this jet, you can populate this region in between. I put I process region, but I don't know exactly how to call, but it's in between the S and R. And this is possible thanks to the combination of the high amount of neon 22 before the explosion that was produced by rotation and the jet-like explosion that allow a high temperature in the helium shell to burn this neon 22. And this, all these two effects are due to rotation. And this leads to an enhanced N process because it's not a new process. Actually, it was already discussed in some old paper of the 70s by for instance, Truran, Tillman, Blake, and et cetera. But it was discussed, I would say, in standard cases, of course, of non-rotating stars and I think spherical explosions. And so this process was already recognized, but it was here, I would say, it's in this case of rotating star and aspherical explosion, it's much more efficient. Okay, so the effect, if you take, for instance, barium, which is about here in this plot, the effect of the neutron burst is roughly to make some very neutron-rich barium. So we go here to the right, to the neutron-rich region, and later on, this material enriched in neutron will decay to the value of stability and form some europium or some elements close to this region. So this is what we can see here. This is here the chemical composition in black just before and red after the jet explosion as a function of mass number. And the effect of the jet basically is to shift the S process peaks to the right. So you see that the black pattern is kind of shifted to the right here. And if indeed some barium, which is here around the second peak, is transformed, I would say, to samarium, europium, as I have shown just here. So there is a kind of shift to the shift of the S process pattern to the right. And here is just a comparison with a RS star. So I mentioned this kind of stars at the beginning that are in between R process and S process stars. And it's just one case, but here we see the best fit given by the non-rotating model in black, the rotating model in blue, and the rotating model plus the jet-like explosion in red. And here you see that only the rotation plus jet can explain this high abundance of europium. So there is a possible link between at least some maybe of these RS stars and this kind of astrophysical sources. So before going to the next part, I would like to mention something that I think is important, is that, there is some, as you can imagine, in every model, there are important uncertainties. And here I would like to mention just one, at least, some uncertainties on the S process in rotating massive stars. So one of the uncertainty is the uncertain rates of these two reactions, oxygen 17 alpha gamma and oxygen 17 alpha N. So why that? Because actually when the S process is happening in helium burning core of massive stars, you have a lot of oxygen 16 in the helium burning core, which is a strong poison that captures a lot of neutrons and forms oxygen 17. And then you have two choices: either the neutron is recycled through this reaction, oxygen 17 alpha N, so the neutron is given back to the medium and can be captured by heavy seeds like iron or strontium, etc., or the neutron is lost through this reaction, oxygen 17 alpha gamma. So the balance between these two reactions is very important for the efficiency of the S process. So if you have a high ratio of oxygen 17 alpha N to alpha gamma, the S process is more efficient and vice versa. And this is the rates of this of one of these two rates, oxygen 17 alpha gamma. And here is the rate divided by some reference. Here the reference is from Coghlan and Fowler 88. This is the reference I took, and the temperature here in the x-axis in giga Kelvin, and the shaded area here shows the temperature range of interest for the helium burning in massive star. And you see that in this domain of temperature, the rate is very uncertain. Actually, the experiments, they give only lower limits in this range of temperature because it's very difficult to have measurements here because the energy and the temperature is very low. And there are some estimations in black here, but they are not actual measurements. And if you compute a stellar evolution model with rotation with the blue rate or with the black rate, you can have an impact on the yields of barium of about one dex at least. So this is a big problem because you see that the uncertainty due to this rate, just this rate, is not low. It's very important. And to have a good idea of the I would say the contribution of these stars to the chemical evolution of the universe, we need to measure well this rate. And I am trying to collaborate with some people in New York that try to, Alison Lair, that try to, for instance, that try to measure these rates. So oxygen 17 alpha gamma and N. Okay, to summarize the first part, so, during the life of the star, of the massive star with rotation, you have some rotational mixing that can transport angular momentum and chemical elements and leads to an enhanced S process. During the supernova, rotation may trigger aspherical explosions, and this can lead to an enhanced N process, so a neutron burst in the helium shell of the star, and the resulting pattern, so chemical pattern, so the material which is ejected in this case has a chemical composition which is intermediate between the S and the R process. And this is maybe a possible link to the RS stars, at least some of them. So yes, this is and maybe also to some S stars, if you consider that the star has a normal explosion, I would say, or just eject some material through winds, you can have an enhanced S process. And in some cases, although of course the S process is mainly due probably to AGB stars, you can have a link of this model to S stars and maybe also to RS stars. Okay, so I would like now to go to the next part, So, which seems a bit different, but actually it's quite linked to the first one. I hope you will see at the end. I can show you this at the end. The second part is, or you can maybe just realize now that yes, it's there are some link actually, even if here I will discuss more the AGB stars, not the massive stars, and the high process that can occur in such models, in such stars. So the high process was first named by Cowan and Rose in 77, and it occurs at neutron densities, which are intermediate between the S and R process. S process here, R process on the right, and I process in the middle, about 10 to the 15. And the kind of definition for the I process is that it's triggered when hydrogen is mixed, or protons are mixed into a convective helium burning zone. And so you have an ingestion of proton in a convective helium burning zone. So it's an interaction between hydrogen and helium burning zones, a bit like before. So if you remember, in the first part, I mentioned interaction between helium and hydrogen burning zones in massive stars. But this kind of interaction I have discussed before is very different than this one. So it's a bit confusing maybe, but before there was no convective, I would say, zones, and the mixing was just radiative. So it yields two differences. In the first part, we had an S process, which was enhanced. And in this part, because we have a convective mixing of hydrogen into helium, we can have an I process. So I understand it's a bit confusing, but these are two differences. These are some differences between the first part, and this is the difference between the first part and the second part. So these are two different kinds of mixing, I would say. This one is a kind of convective mixing. And the very important reactions for the I process are these three reactions. Actually, when the protons are ingested in the helium burning zone, you have a lot of carbon 12 that reacts with the protons to produce some nitrogen 13, and that quickly decay in about 10 minutes to carbon 13, and then carbon 13 alpha, so helium 4, gives oxygen and a neutron. So you can here release some neutrons and make the I process happen. This is a list of some possible astrophysical sites where proton ingestion can occur, and then the I process. I try to put some characteristics to highlight some characteristics of these sites. Here in orange are the sites that are only at low metallicity. For instance, the first site is AGB stars at low metallicity and low mass stars. It was discussed by different people. Also, the core helium flash of very low metallicity low mass stars. Maybe in low metallicity super AGB stars, it can also happen. And in massive stars during the end of the evolution. Here in green, these are the sites where that involve a low mass star. So you see on the first here, the first slide, this slide, that there is a kind of preference maybe for the low metallicity for the I process. It may more happen at low metallicity. Of course, it's just very qualitative here. It can also maybe happen at higher metallicities, but there are quite a lot of sites at low metallicity and quite a lot of sites in low mass stars also. But it can also probably happen in massive stars. So there are quite a lot of different sites. And here in blue, it happens during the last stages of the evolution of the star. So in general, it happens very late in the evolution, the I process. And in red, this is a site where we need a binary system to accrete some material and to make the I process happen. Here in I try to highlight the works that considered actually really I process, that they followed the I process nucleosynthesis. Because in some works, for instance, the Fujimoto, they discussed the proton ingestion events and some nucleosynthesis of light elements, but they do not discuss and do not follow actually the I process. So let me focus on this specific site here, AGB stars, AGB phase of low metallicity, low mass stars, which is one possible site for the high process. And here is I would like just to, before to say a few words on AGB stars. This is an Espromeau-Rochelle diagram of an AGB star of two solar mass, starting its life here on the main sequence and going through the RGB here phase, red giant branch, and then asymptotic giant branch here, so AGB. So this is the phase we are interested in. Then post-AGB, and then ends its life as a white dwarf. Yeah. And I think the numbers are giving the approximate duration of the different stages. So the main sequence is very long. So it's in log. And then the RGB phase is shorter, AGB phase is even shorter, etc. And during this AGB phase, the star looks like this. So this is the internal structure of an AGB star. And this phase is actually defined so that there is a nitrogen and helium that burns in thin shells on top of the carbon oxygen core. So this is a slice of the AGB star, carbon oxygen core, thin helium shell and intershell region, and then hydrogen burning shell, and then convective envelope here. And it was shown first by Schwarzschild and Arm in 65 that regularly at regular intervals, there are some thermal instabilities of the helium shells that we call thermal pulses. And during these thermal pulses, the helium shell that is usually quite quiet becomes very active, and you see it increase in size and becomes convective here. So in a stellar evolution model, here is a model computed with the star evol code that is mostly developed here by Lionel Sies. Here is the Kippenen diagram. So if you are not familiar with this, it's showing here, the x-axis is showing the model number or the time, if you prefer, it's kind of time. And the y-axis is the mass coordinate of the star. So it means that at zero, you are at the center, one, you are at the surface of the star. And here, the gray area are showing the convective zones. So you have the convective envelope here, and this is here, the thermal pulse that starts here and ends here, the convective thermal pulse in the one solar mass star here. And the green lines are showing where hydrogen is burning. And the dotted blue line is showing where helium is burning. So here it's kind of normal pulse. There is no ingestion of protons in the pulse, in the helium zone. But it was first shown, I think, by Fujimoto, Japanese, I think, if I have seen well, but that the entropy barrier between the hydrogen and helium-rich zones can be actually surmounted by the energy released by the thermal pulse. So you can actually, here there is a kind of barrier that can be overcome by the energy of the thermal pulse. So here there is an event happening, but in some cases you can have this. So this is here the same model a bit later, so the next pulse actually, I think. And here is the start again of the pulse, but then here you see that actually the hydrogen burning is mixing with the helium burning. So you can see this by seeing that the green and the green line is going down in the helium burning zone, while before it was just staying above. So here there is a pulse with ingestion of protons. And you can see here on the top the time scale, which is about 10 years here, on the time scale of the plot. And the first thing that you can see is that actually the stellar structure is very different. And this is because the release, the nuclear energy, modifies the stellar structures, especially because of the C12 P gamma reaction. I will come back on this just after. So what happens here, globally, you have the protons that are ingested into the convective helium burning shell. And this reaction becomes very strong here, C12 P gamma, and then the beta decay of nitrogen. And the carbon-13 is then transported again and transport it to the bottom of the pulse where the temperature is very high or is high enough to activate very efficiently this reaction C13 alpha N. And this leads to the high process with the neutron density in this case going up to about 10 to the 15. So about nucleosynthesis, it's like this. So here is the chemical composition, actually here in this point, so at the bottom of the pulse, during the high process. And it's just a region of the elements, I would say, around europium. So here you have, just to show you how it works, I think it's interesting to see it like this. You have here the two stable europium isotopes, which are 151 and 153, which are here. And actually, during the high process, you have a high neutron density, so you form very neutron-rich isotopes. And for europium, for instance, you can see here, you will form some europium 158 and 9. That will, of course, later decay to the valley of stability. But during the nucleosynthesis, you can form very neutron-rich isotopes. Okay, so going back to this plot, what happened next after the nucleosynthesis? So you have that just after the nucleosynthesis, then actually during, the nucleosynthesis products are transported up to the surface through the stars, through the convective zones. And later on, actually, some years later, they are going up in the stars and reaching the surface. And let's now just zoom out. So this is here the same plot, but we zoomed, I just zoom out a lot. Before, we were in this small rectangle, red rectangle here. And here is the same plot, but okay, the x-axis is now the time or similar to time. And before, we were here. So when the proton ingestion occurred, it was here in this small box here. And here was the start of the AGB phase. And what happened is that you see the black line here, that is the total mass of the star, is decreasing very fast. So it means that the star is losing a lot of mass. And this is because the products of nucleosynthesis here are transported up to the surface. So the high process elements, but also the light elements like carbon and nitrogen or oxygen. And this makes the surface metallicity increasing a lot, increase the opacity and the radius of the star, and this triggers strong mass loss. And this actually make the end of the AGB phase. There is no more thermal pulse. You see that there is maybe one first pulse here, second pulse, there is this special event, and then the mass is lost very fast, and there is no time for AGB phase to continue with further thermal pulses. So at least in this model, we have this kind of peculiar evolution. So here you see that the interstellar medium will be enriched in high process material because the star here has lost about 0.3, 0.4, 0.5 maybe solar mass. So I would like to discuss quickly this, which are possible chemical fingerprint of the high process in an IGB star, but this is about isotopic ratio that I think are quite interesting and promising to try to identify the different nucleosynthetic processes. So this is here showing the isotopic fraction of some isotopes, which are defined like this. So for C13, for instance, it's just the amount of C13 divided by the amount of stable carbon isotopes. So for carbon, we have two stable isotopes, 12 and 13, and then we compute the fraction. And the sun, the fraction of isotopic fraction in the sun are shown by these stars here, orange, the solar R process by blue stars, the previous models, I process model by black circle, and the S process, typical S process, I would say, by red circles. So you see that there are some, for instance, for barium 137, you can probably say if it's more I process, more R process, or more S process. So that would be interesting fingerprint of the I process, I think. And what's important to mention, I think, is that we know some metal poor stars with where some observers determined the some isotopic ratios. Isotopic ratio for barium in some works, for europium, for samarium and neodymium. And this is extremely and very yes, very challenging to derive the isotopic ratios in stars, but it was done in some works. And for instance, here is an example in a work from Aoki-san. Of course, there is a kind of big error bar because I think he said in his work that it depends on the atomic data, it depends on quite a lot of things, but he could derive the fraction of europium 155 and 151 in one RS star, which has this name. And it was actually about 0.6, 0.7. And it's difficult to say something, but it's compatible with an I process, actually, and probably also compatible with R process you see here, although it's at the very bottom at the limit. So that could be interesting, I think, to determine some isotopic fraction in metal poor stars, and in order to really to, because these isotopic ratios, that they really tell something on the nucleosynthesis. Here is a case that doesn't work very well. It is another case from a work from Meng for the barium as isotopic ratios. And Meng in 2016, they have shown that the sum of these two black circles, or actually the sum of these two barium isotopes should be about 0.2. And here in this model, we see that the sum of these two black circles is actually 0.2 plus 0.5, it's 0.7. So there is a problem here, and this star, this RS star observed by Meng, is not compatible with an I process, probably, or with this I process. So yes, this raised the question of what is the origin of this star. It may be a combination of S and I process, because S process, you see, it's red here, it gives a very low, a very low ratio. It would give the F would be about 0.1 or 0.2. So I don't know, it's difficult to say, but yeah. And just last slide, maybe. This is in this work here, 2021 with Lionel Cies and Stéphane Gorielli, we did some comparisons. I really wanted to show the isotopic ratio, which I think are interesting and promising. So even if it's very challenging to get them in metal poor stars, but here we also did some comparisons of element by element and star to star with our model. So we just try to fit the chemical composition of 14 RS stars. Carbon enhanced metal poor stars, actually, but let's say just RS stars that have a low metallicity close to our model. And we see here in this summary plot on the bottom right that our I process model here in red is giving a bit better results than an R process, a solar R process. We try to fit actually these stars also with the R process and the S process. And yes, here we show that the chi-square value, so the quality of the fit, is better if we consider I process. So I will not discuss much more of this, but yes, just that I think to me, this is quite interesting to try to determine some isotopic ratio in metal poor stars. I'm quite excited about this. So to summarize, for the first part, maybe I will say it quickly, but I discussed massive stars with rotation at low metallicity. We can have an enhanced S process and enhanced N process during the explosion. And for the part two, I discussed the high process, and hydrogen can be mixed into the convective helium burning zone of low metallicity low mass AGB stars. The chemicals can go up to the surface and trigger strong mass loss that will stop the AGB phase. And then the high process leads to specific isotopic ratios. So in these two parts, there is, I think this is the link of all of this. These two kind of sources, they may be linked to these peculiar stars that we call RS stars or I stars that show intermediate patterns between the R and the S process. So I will stop here. I discussed mostly these three papers, especially this one, the 2020 and 2021. I really thanks my collaborators, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Arthur. So now let's move to the questions. So okay, we have some hands already. Okay, have one for Pavel. Yes, Pavel.
thank you, Arthur. It was very interesting. I have a few comments and two questions. My comments are first about rapidly accreting white walls. They also produce high process at low metallicities. You didn't mention that. And also in our papers, we followed nuclear synthesis and rapidly accreting white walls, not for one model, but for many models. So now the last comment that I have is about high process in Sakurai objects during very light thermal pulse. I think that so far this is the only observational evidence of high process going on. So that actually went on at 1999, okay. And now my questions, first about jets and the explosion of massive stars. It was very interesting. You say that jets actually enhance end process, and you connected this enhanced end process with RS stars, right? But RS stars are CMP RS stars, so they are carbon enhanced. So my question is, do you produce enough carbon in jets during massive star explosion to explain not only I process enrichment, but also carbon enrichment? This is the first question.
Yeah, so we can produce carbon. So here you see that these models here, without or with fast rotation, they produce some carbon here at z equals six, because yes, there is actually quite a lot of carbon in the, for instance, in the helium shell, and in this specific case, at least, it works. But sometimes, of course, it's very difficult to reproduce all the light and heavy elements. But in this case, we could, even if it's a bit below, you see here the carbon is a bit below, but it's not so far. Yeah.
I see. Okay, thank you. And my second question and the last question is about high process in low mass, low metallicity AGB stars. Yeah. So in this model, in your model, I process yields, they are actually first mixed in a massive convective envelope of the AGB star, right? And later, when they are created by CMPRS stars, future CMPRS stars, they will have to be also mixed in a massive convective envelope of CMPRS stars, which is on the regine branch. And the majority of CMPRS stars are on the regine branch. So you mentioned Hempel et al. Results that nicely fit observational data, but they assume, like our rapidly accreting white dwarf model, assume that the amount of I process yields that you need to mix in CMPR stars is less than 1%. But in your model, as far as I remember, requires almost about 80% of dilution, right? How you deal with this? Can you explain this?
Yeah, no, you are totally right. Actually, it's I have I would have should maybe mention this, but I hope I have. Yes, this is a scenario for the accretion. So here we have the AGB star with high process, and then there is some mass lost, which is accreted by the secondary that become a RS star. So this is a kind of scenario, binary mass transfer scenario. And that's right, that even if we can reproduce the abundance distribution in relative ratios. Actually, with simple estimates, you see that there is some problem, some issue for the absolute amount of material that needs to be accreted by the RS star, and it needs to be very high. And for this, you need a very high and even non-realistic sometimes accretion rate, and that many, many mass should be accreted by this RS star. Even if the ratio are fine, the X over iron, but the total mass is needs to be very high to be accreted. So this is actually an issue, and we don't have the answer now. We think about this, so there are different possibilities, but I cannot give a very good answer now. What I can say just is that there is this problem for, I think sometimes, already for the S stars. So if you consider this scenario for the S stars, this would be exactly the same, just that the AGB star is... this problem is happening for the S stars and also the RS stars. So that's right. And
I see. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Pavel. So we have a question on the chat from Carlos Abia. Which will be the I process contribution to the solar system abundances of the heavy elements?
We don't know. Actually, I would say my naive answer would be that when we see these solar abundances, it seems that an S and an R process are well reproducing these abundances. So maybe in the previous sources before the sun, before the birth of the sun, there was at some point a source producing the S and the R process, but no source producing the I process. So maybe the sun is a kind of star without I process. I don't know. I'm not sure. And if you look at other stars, you may have some, they are very different than the sun, and you can probably see some stars with the, as I have discussed here, with the I process. But for the sun, maybe an S and R process are enough, I would say.
Okay. Any more questions for Arthur? Okay, I can ask a couple. Can you go to your slide 10 where you have the abundance of the... Yeah. So this one is just one of your tracer particles, or just an integrated?
Yes, it's just one. Yes, right. Just one. Particle, okay. Close to the jet axis in the helium shell.
Uh-huh. Okay, very good. Any other questions? Okay, I'll ask one more. So can you go to your slide 7 with the effect of the rotation? Yeah. Okay, yeah, this one. So I have two questions. Actually, it's one. So here we see that this is a very high rotating star, 700 kilometers per second, even though you showed in the previous one that the distribution doesn't go much farther than 400 or so.
Exactly, yes.
If you get a star with a velocity, rotation velocity of 500 and 300, they possibly fall in between those two. But how much is the effect of increasing the rotation by a factor of 2, let's say, to the final abundances? Is there a correlation, or it's just kind of random?
No, there is a kind of continuity between no rotation and fast rotation. So I cannot say exactly here, but if you take 300, it will be,
in the middle.
In between.
Yeah.
And just to mention that here, the rotation seems very fast. That's right. But compared to here, when you look at this plot, it seems to stop at 400. But this is for solar metallicity, actually, for stars.
Right, because they're very, these are old stars.
When you consider very low metallicity stars, they are much more compact. And then if you put the same amount of angular momentum than at solar metallicity, because they are more compact, they will rotate.
Okay, and now if you have the same model with the same fast rotation and you just change the metallicity of the model, how does that affect? So do the lower metallicity models have a bigger effect in the rotation or no?
There is a point in that there is a kind of threshold, maybe at iron over hydrogen of -3, -4, where the S process will just be about, I think, very small, because you don't have enough seeds. You need some seeds, iron to start
with. Some iron, nickel. Okay, cool.
And I think the peak of the efficiency of the S process is, if you include rotation, would be around at low metallicity, but not too low. So maybe
right.
Iron over hydrogen would be around -2 or so.
That's right. Okay. Any more questions? I don't see. You can also unmute yourself if you want to ask something. Okay. I don't see anything. I'll just post again the link to the GatherTown. Oh, yeah, there's a question from Alex. Yes.
Hi, sorry, Arthur. Hi. I have a question about sort of the duration of the neutron burst in the jet, and in terms of how. So that was the result of a simulation calculation, like how long that happened. But how tunable is that, I guess, given the differences in the progenitor stars? Is it always going to be very similar, or is it going to be potentially different? So we should expect different amounts of end process.
You are discussing the time, the duration of the jet, right?
Yeah, and I guess in particular, whether if changing that affects the nucleus.
Yes. Okay. So in this case, there is an energy deposition rate. So here, there is a deposition rate, the E dot of 10 to the 51 per second. So the total energy is 10 to the 51 times 10, because 10 seconds, and then 10 to the 52. So if you take the same amount of energy, the total energy, and you increase the duration of the jet, you will have much less high temperature actually in the helium shell, because the jet will be, the energy will be, I would say, not concentrated in a short amount of time. It will be diluted in 100 seconds, for instance, and then the temperature in the helium shell will not reach high temperature, and this reaction will not be so much efficiently activated, and the neutron burst will be much smaller. So in this sense, if you, I would say this neutron capture process will be much less efficient if you consider a long jet, I think.
I see, that makes a lot of sense. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Alex. I don't see any other questions on the chat or any hands. So let's thank Arthur again one more time. And we'll move to the Gina room. So if you don't join us, I would like to wish you happy holidays, and we'll be back next year with the IRENA seminar series. So thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.